So it's good to go.
We're done.
We're off.
Play fall asleep there.
We're back with Mike and he's having his gravel for breakfast.
Yeah.
With his gravelly voice.
I know. Sounding more and more like Joe Cocker the older I get. I've noticed this.
Yeah.
I don't smoke. Rarely drink. I don't know what it is. Maybe years have been choked. Maybe that's it.
Rusky.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you do physios for throats or?
There are actually some vocal coach physios in there. So it's a broad profession.
You need to fix my hips first.
What's the... What's the predominant profession for people that needs their throats helped out?
Singing.
Singing.
Yeah. And others, amongst others. We'll go into those.
Well, as you might hear, we're joined by our first ever guest on the North Leeds Jitz podcast. So.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Tom. And Tom's joining us because he's from Indergaard Physiotherapy. And he's going to... We've just partnered with them this past week to bring extra benefit to our members, and we wanted Tom to come on to explain a little bit about what he does. He does jiu-jitsu as well, so we're going to talk a lot about that. And we've had a few questions come in, which we'll get to as well.
Yeah, it's exciting, man. I think this for me is from the business before we get into all that kind of stuff.
For sure,
it's such an important partnership because. On two levels, when Uwe came over, the guy who started Indergaard Physio, and obviously he's got a lot of experience in grappling. He was the head judo physio right for GB. We spoke about two things. One, it's about the benefit to our members and to ensure they remain healthy and are able to train jiu-jitsu for as long as possible, because that's what we all want, right? But two, for both businesses, we share a lot of values. And I think that's something that we'll probably explore maybe on a different podcast. Maybe we'll get into it today. But I think that's wonderful because what we're doing actually is we're just broadening out our positive message to as many people as possible. And so the Indergaard community, I've already been messaged by a couple of people who you know, are clients of your clinic. And you know, they say great things about you and they say great things about other people that you work with, including Uwe. So that's just an awesome thing to be part of. So thank you, Indergaard, for being part of the
family. No, thank you.
Family.
It's good to be part of it, to be honest. And I think I kind of echo your sentiments that we kind of feel like we share the same values and building that community, but also improving health. I think there's often a big misconception about physio being that you're injured, you go see physio. But quite a few people who come to see me are trying to maintain or improve. And I think that's the essence of jiu-jitsu as well, isn't it, right? It's that self-improvement, that progression.
Definitely.
Maybe that would be a nice place to start. So just with the question of what is physiotherapy, and then maybe we can contrast that with like the specialities that you guys go into. But on a baseline, what does physiotherapy mean? And
so physiotherapy, obviously in essence, we're breaking it down to physical therapy, and they use that in the States more than we use physiotherapy. So physical therapy or physiotherapy is using physical-based interventions, exercise, manual techniques, amongst other things, to better people's health. Now, probably not a lot of people understand is the three aspects to physiotherapy. Typically, what you'll see is musculoskeletal physiotherapists. So treating injuries, bones, joints, ligaments, those sorts of things. But there are two more aspects to it. There's neurological physiotherapy. So when I worked for pediatrics in the NHS, I worked a lot with children who'd sustained brain injuries at an early age, working with things like cerebral palsy or people who've suffered strokes. And then alongside that, there's respiratory physiotherapy. So in my last stint in the NHS, I worked on intensive care, which the role itself is more around managing chest conditions. So if you have someone in ICU who's been ventilated and sedated, they can't produce a productive cough, they're at high risk of chest infections. So you'll be the person who tries to get those secretions out of their chest. And then amongst that, I used to work on call. So in the middle of the night, you might get a phone call saying, can you come in? We've got someone whose oxygen saturations are dropping. They can't clear secretions. Can you? It's more of like an emergency type situation. So it's quite a broad profession.
Right.
There's many aspects to it, really.
And generally, does someone specialise down one of those three paths?
Typically, there are some that are quite well integrated. And I think you need to be versed in all three to a degree to understand. So there are aspects of neurological rehab that I'll use in my MSK practice. and there are aspects of respiratory that I use, particularly things like breath work, which I think is a massively neglected aspect of it too.
Okay, excellent. So then that's like a broad definition of what physiotherapy is. More narrowed down, tell me about Indergaard and what you guys predominantly work on.
Okay, so Indergaard Physiotherapy is more of like a sports specialist clinic, but that doesn't mean that we see only athletes. That's probably a 20-30%, maybe 40% of our caseload. It's people with general sort of aches and pains. And so Indergaard Physiotherapy is kind of the philosophy, really, is getting people not just better, but being capable to do what they want to do and to be able to exceed maybe their expectations sometimes. So I actually only joined the clinic in October full time, and I started working part time around sort of July. So I was a bit of a crossroads in my career. I was a bit, my morale was quite low working in the NHS because I had all this desire and this passion, and I was really trying to put it into my job, but I just couldn't. And then I'd made friends with a physio through Instagram in London, who I saw, I did a post about a clinic in Leeds called Indergaard Physio. And then we got talking, and I got in touch with Uwe that way. And then we just had a lot of conversations. And it got to a point where I just asked, can I come down and can we have a chat? Because I'd like to link with someone who shares the same philosophy as me around kind of empowerment and just helping people see the positive of physio. Because I think a lot of times people just feel that it's, I can only just get to a baseline level of function. And for what I saw from Uwe, and his passion was about getting people better, but getting people independent as well. And so one thing that I think Indergaard does very well, kind of two things I think they do very well, is making a specific diagnosis. So being able to actually understand what's going on. And then alongside that, it's being able to get people to walk out independent. So one of the best parts of my job is I'll have someone come in with something like back pain or a shoulder pain, and I've seen them for a few weeks, and then they'll come back in 2 or 3 week break in between and say, you know, I had a really bad day, but I went and did those exercises you showed me in the first week and that calmed it down. And then you give people the tools to manage their problems and their concerns. So you don't make them reliant on you. You empower them and you kind of encourage them to manage those conditions themselves, which is, it's honestly the highlight of my job.
Right. And how does that contrast from maybe like your previous roles with the NHS and things like that?
Yeah. So in the NHS, it's not me saying, oh, the NHS is rubbish. And I think a lot of that can go around. I just think it's a massively strained service, and a lot of the outcomes that you would want to have with patients and clients, you can't necessarily achieve because of the constraints that are placed upon your time. And that has an effect on your morale, because there's plenty of people when I was in the NHS I just wanted to do more for, but doing more would require me to go far, far, far beyond what my contracted hours would, or my time on my resources would. And that eventually led to me feeling just quite burnt out, to be honest.
Yeah. Maybe we should go quite far back and then build our way up to you joining a guard, and maybe that can give some people around your values and why those matched up nicely with Indergaard. So where are you from originally, Tom?
So I'm actually from Yeadon, just near the airport. So yeah. North Leeds, well, technically North Leeds.
Just,
barely. So raised in North Leeds, I did just schooled around there, went to university at Leeds University, and first did a degree in exercise physiology.
And was that kind of something you had always wanted to do since you were a kid?
Yeah, so I always loved sport. I was rubbish at school until I was about 16, and then I realised I could run fast. And then that kind of drove my engagement with academia, because I saw those the impact of hard work just in the context of sport, and then how that transpired into other components of my life. And so I think sport teaches you a valuable lesson about self-improvement and humility.
Yeah. And what was the sport that kind of got you on the hook?
So I started doing 100 metres and triple jump, and then did that for a little bit. I won the Yorkshire Championships in triple jump, and then I did quite well in that for a little bit, but then that went onto the back burner. And then when I went to university, I started to pick some training up again, and then got involved in skeleton bobsleigh, which is a strange sport as it is anyway, coming from Yeadon. It's not like I was raised in West Germany.
Yeah.
And so we went through that, and then eventually through doing sport and seeing the impact it had in my life and physical fitness had in my life, and then with my degree alongside that, I thought I need to get involved in a profession I'm really passionate about.
And during those kind of first, from 16 maybe onwards, when you say you really got into this stuff, do you experience any particular injuries or anything?
Skeleton was pretty riddled with injuries. Throwing yourself down a track at 80 miles an hour will inevitably lead to some. So had a fractured rib, had the worst pain I ever experienced doing skeleton. It sounds so small, is coming out of a corner, my legs splayed out, and just on the outside of the heel, I whacked it on the ice as my legs kind of whipped across, and my ankle was swollen for so, so long. Still think I had a bit of a fracture, but I just kept training through it. But I had back pain for probably 4 years, and that got quite serious.
And were you fairly diligent with your kind of rehab and stuff like that, or did you kind of try and plough through it?
Yeah, I think so. But I think in elite sport, there's a different mindset. It's about getting you to the event and to be able to compete at the event rather than that sort of sustainability of long-term health. So most athletes who are focused on the Olympic Games, it's about getting to the next cycle, being able to peak your performance at the Olympic Games or at these important events.
Mm.
And then kind of fitting your rehab in the pre-seasons just to kind of squeeze it in and come back prepared, really.
So after uni, what happens? What do you want to do, and where are you in life?
So I finished university, and then shortly after finished skeleton, I was a little bit lost because there's not too much you can do with an exercise physiology degree. And to be honest, I didn't do as well as I could have done in my degree because I was doing skeleton at the same time. So I did some strange jobs. I worked as an aircraft dispatcher at Leeds Bradford Airport for a little bit.
Using your Eden contacts, as
I say, I'm cool, man.
You can tell. I did so many jobs at the airport. I did baggage handling, I did check-in, and then I reached the lofty heights of aircraft dispatcher.
I see.
And then...
were you correcting everyone's form when they were picking the bags up?
I wasn't quite there physio-wise. Yeah, I didn't know what I was doing, to be honest. And then, I went into an office job for about 18 months, and it was at that point I was doing a sports massage qualification, and I just remember leaving work one day and saying to myself, I could leave this at 65 with a pension, but I'd have just thought that was all right. And so I went home and I kind of talked about it with my wife, and she said to me, she was like, well, what's 3 years in 30 years time? And that was a big turning point for me. And when I went through being a student, a physiotherapy student, and eventually qualifying, I saw that the passion that I had and the interest that I had in my profession kind of just shortened that, well, made that learning curve a lot quicker.
So you went back and re-qualified as a physio.
Yeah.
All right, so, what does that look like? What's that process like?
So it's just, I went and did another undergraduate degree.
Right.
So it was 3 years of training again. But obviously I went in there with quite good knowledge about strength and conditioning and physiology, which really, really helped. And then I just went full obsessed because it was nice to have that passion, to be able to pursue what I'm really interested in. It's having done the office job that I didn't like and going into a profession that I really enjoy, I can't explain the difference when you wake up in the morning in terms of desire.
So after you do your physiotherapy degree, or does it just like physiotherapy jobs for getting fired at you, or what was the case?
The kind of thought process is you go into the NHS, you develop some experience, and you eventually go into private practice. Problem I found in the NHS is I didn't really feel particularly challenged. A lot of these principles of strength, which it largely is, if people are relatively inactive, they're quite easy to rehab. And then I just never really felt like it was the culture that was right for me, for some more so. And I really liked being in a hospital environment, helping people. I'm one of these people who is, I know what I want. And I think initially when I was younger, my parents would probably have called me hot-headed, but I've always kind of knew where I wanted to go, and I'll kind of just contact people and find that way. And so I ended up leaving the NHS and then just trying to find the right clinic. So I shadowed a few local clinics, and then obviously meeting up with Uwe was a game changer for me, really, because we shared those philosophies of he's... One thing that stood out to me when I met him, and then when I started to be employed by him, he came up with like a 3-year plan. And so it goes through different aspects of your life. You talk about your finances, you talk about family relationships, physical health, mental health, professional development. And you kind of set a score out of 10 where you think you are at the moment. And then you write a statement, which is speaking in the present tense, 3 years in the future. So I have done this in the last 3 years. And I have never been in a job where someone's done that with me.
Right, he did that with you.
Yeah.
Right.
And that kind of says a lot about the practice. Yeah. It's about that personal and professional development, but guiding you through that process.
I heard Jordan Peterson talk about something like that he does with his psychology students, similar thing, like talking about your life in the future, depending on which path you take, right?
Yeah.
Like the one where you still... doing a job you hate, like, what are you talking like there? And the one when you're doing the thing you want to do. So quite a powerful thing, right, in terms of dialing in your aspirations. And also, I suppose, what it did for you was really you understood who Uwe was and kind of how he could help you, how he was invested in you as a person, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Quite powerful.
And that says a lot, right, because you want to work for people who you respect and in turn you feel respected. So I had an interesting conversation with one of my managers before I left. And when I was working with cerebral palsy, there's a lot of spasticity associated with brain injuries. Some muscles really struggle to switch off because of that acquired brain injury. And so there's a treatment, what they normally do is they Botox these muscles just to help them relax. And so you'd see children come in with this cerebral palsy and they'd get Botoxed every 6 months. And some of the evidence would suggest that it's not good for muscles. And also, you don't want to be sticking needles in kids. It's not a very nice experience for them. And so I came across shockwave therapy, which Uwe uses quite a lot. And I started to read some of the academic research about that. And the evidence shows that it's as effective as Botox, but it doesn't have some of these problems. And I presented it to one of my managers. And I remember saying to me, you'll get in trouble for thinking like that. And I was quite shocked. Like when
not for challenging the norm or for...
Yeah, and almost because they were like, oh, you've not thought about this because I was less qualified than them.
Right, okay.
And I was like, actually, I have. Like, this is the research. I've read 5 or 6 papers. I've communicated with the person who's integrated it in Spain. And that for me is I just don't need those barriers. I don't need those battles. And having stepped into Indergaard, we can do that. You know, I said, I want to work with Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and here we are. You know, we're having that conversation. It's giving someone the tools to go and do that themselves. And whenever I've needed some guidance, I've got someone there, but just lets me crack on.
Yeah, it seems quite forward thinking. That's what really attracted me. I mean, funny though, because I didn't realise at the time, so when we'd spent some time together and you mentioned that quite a lot of CrossFitters go to Indergaard. Yeah. I remember, we were talking maybe 4 or 5 years ago, and I said this to him when he came down. Matt Robbo, who runs CrossFit Regain, I think they're Elios now, he'd said to me, I'd gone for a sports massage with him, and he obviously is an ex-Marine as well, and kind of know him. And he said, oh, there's this great guy down in, like, this Norwegian fella down in Garth, if you can't get fixed, like, he's, like, the best around.
Mm.
So people were already starting to talk, right?
Yeah.
And that happens when people are pushing boundaries and they're kind of trying to, like, squeeze out every little drop of what they know and what they can offer.
Yeah.
People who stand still, and like the lady you spoke about, who don't want to entertain any new ideas, no one talks about them.
No.
And that's what really attracted me to Indergaard, that it felt like you guys were pushing forward and you were at the very top of your game,
yeah.
But you weren't standing still.
And it's nice as well to be around and working with someone who you know has those answers. So funny story, I went in this week and had some really bad pain. So my clavicles were really hurting. I could just feel this pain in my chest. And when I relaxed, it was super painful. I was like, Uwe, can you just have a look at this? I'm like, what is this wizardry? I laid on the table and he just started to massage my sternum. And I'm like, what's going on here? Retested and the pain's gone. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, it's like a wizard. And I think, you know, you need to be around people like that. People that you respect, but you know, are knowledgeable, but don't lord that over you.
Do you feel like that when I roll with you, team?
No,
like an element of wizardry. No,
no wizardry. No, just impending doom and suffering,
followed by a cry in the toilet.
Yeah. The fetal position in the corner while my kids are showing. Okay, quick break there, but we're back, and I was just wondering for Tom if there's anything where someone comes into your clinic and they've got something particularly wrong with them, and in a strange way, you feel like you've got all the answers and you know kind of like, perfect, I know what I'm going to do with this person and the treatment methods and we're good to go, I've got you back.
Yeah, so the one I strangely enjoy is tendinopathies. Some people might commonly use things like tendonitis as nuances to the definition, but in essence it's when the tendon goes into a state of disrepair. And there's different ways that we can fix that. It's usually coming down to overloading, so they're training too much too often and not giving themselves time to recover. Or there's sometimes biomechanical factors that can impact that, where the tendon starts becoming rubbed against different tissues and it can aggravate that. And that's my favorite thing, is when they come in, I can see them start saying like different points, and it's ticking my tendinopathy box because I'm planning the rehab for a long time. And there's part of me with my own ego that loves to have people walk away going, whoa, like this is going to fix me. And I see quite a lot of that. And when we combine it with different treatments, it's just a different level, because they've gone to see different physios before who haven't been specific in their diagnosis, and they've been given things that might be counterproductive to tendon pain, like massive amounts of stretching, those sorts of things. So when someone comes in with a tendinopathy and they walk out with a plan, so it's not, oh, one session, right, we're going to look at this. You say, right, these are your benchmarks. We'll test you here. When we come back, and by the time you finish, you should be able to do this movement without pain. You should be able to do your sport, waking up the next day without pain. And then when they walk out there saying, you know what, in 8 weeks, 12 weeks, 14 weeks time, I'm going to be back uninhibited to sport or to activity, that's pretty cool.
Aside from me kind of, your primary role is like this physiotherapist. Is there ever an element of like human psychology where you've kind of got to convince a person to like take a step away from training, even though they might just like, oh, I'm going to blast through it, I'll be all right eventually?
Yeah, I mean, a big part of the job in essence is behavior change, because they've got themselves into this position due to behaviors, or also due to a lack of education in certain areas. It's not that everyone's job to be physios, right, or strength coaches, but the biggest challenge I face is with those who overtrain. So I had someone come to see me a few weeks ago with a tendinopathy, and I said, right, you're going to have to back your training off a little bit. Do this, do this, do this. But if you hit these benchmarks, you'll be back training to full level in this amount of time. I've got a few emails from them saying like, can I do this? Can I do this? Like a list of exercises. Can I do, can I do, can I do, can I do? But then they came to see me a few days ago. They're like, oh, it feels loads better. They're like, I did have a breakdown at some point in the week, so I wanted to train, but I'm like, it's eyes on the prize, right? And you've got yourself into the situation. And then when you walk away from it and they've gone out of there saying, I can manage my pain effectively, I've got tools for this, that's a game changer, because they've grown, their mindset's changed, and they're so much more educated about their condition, rather than me just saying, oh, it's knee pain, we'll fix it, and them not knowing anything else about it.
Do you feel like the role of kind of the physiotherapist and like strength coaches and things like that are becoming more and more important as that we see an increase in things like, you know, people sitting down more, on the phones more, eating not so healthy, these kind of things? Do you see the role of like the strength coach and physiotherapy like thing almost rising in almost similar levels as where like doctors are for like treating disease and things like that?
Yeah, and so recently the NHS implemented something called first contact physios. So what they saw was a massive amount of referrals into GP surgeries for musculoskeletal pain. And so actually they said it's probably in our best interest to have a physio at the GP clinic, because they're more suited to deal with these conditions. So just as a bit of statistic, since people started working from home, since the first lockdown, 80% of those people who started working from home reported a new musculoskeletal complaint. And so there's definitely a place for it, but I think it's raising awareness for that, because some people think physio is only for post-surgical problems, or it's something when I'm in the hospital, but in reality it's little aches and pains. It's about, you have the right to be pain-free, and you have the right to be able to live your life in a way that is sustainable and you feel like you can meet the demands of it. And if you feel like you can't meet the demands of your life because of pain, then that's the time you should see a physio.
Have you met a lot of people who've kind of just withdrawn to the fact that they've just accepted that they're going to be in pain for however long, or just for the rest of their lives?
Yeah, probably one of the best experiences I had a few weeks ago, well, months ago, a man came to see me who'd been walking with a stick for the last 4 years with back pain. Came to see me, same old story. I've just come here, my wife's dragged me here, I don't think you can help me. And I was like, what's your pain like through the week? And it's like, it's 9 out of 10. And this person said to me at some point they'd even considered things like suicide. It was that bothering them that much. And so I said, instead of us looking at pain as the measure, let's have some objective markers. So we'll look at specific range of movements, where your symptoms are flaring up. And when we shifted that focus from pain and we changed that focus to range of movement and then hitting these little markers, third session he came in without his stick. He's like, my pain is like a 2 out of 10. He's like, I can walk again. I never thought I could do that. And I didn't really do a lot, but we worked together and we set goals together. And so, like I mentioned before, it's that trade-off of you coming in wanting answers and you're leaving with some of your own answers, and you can look for your life and say, this might be contributing it, or this might be contributing to it. And then you work together to get that outcome.
Was that a mindset shift for him then? Like, instead of focusing completely on the pain, he's now focusing on other things to try and focus on, like the range of movement. So pain isn't the only conversation, right?
Yeah.
And even that can change how we feel pain, right? Like, yeah, if we're telling ourselves we're in pain, we're going to feel more of it.
Yeah.
And if we tell ourselves, actually, I'm maybe not feeling as much pain, or I've achieved something else, I think pain can decrease. It's definitely a lot to do with getting that balance, I would suggest, between the actual physiological thing and the mental approach too, right?
Yeah, and in pain, you'll hear physios go on and on about it, but we talk about pain as being multifactorial, right? And it is a subjective thing. You know, your pain is different to my pain, and people have had pain for a long time. Some of the research that's shown that if you're exposed to pain for long periods of time, it can create changes in the brain where things like touch to you, which feels fine, becomes painful to them. And so it's unpacking some of those processes as well. And that can be a long thing. Like, I think chronic pain is often dealt with not with a lot of care. So I've had a lot of people coming with things like fibromyalgia, or problems where they've dealt with pain for so long. And because it's an exclusion by diagnosis, other people assume that it's fake. And it's not that, it's just so complex. You need to pick apart these lifestyle factors. It's not that they're doing anything wrong in their life, but what's their perception of what's going in the joint versus what's my perception of what's going in the joint?
Exactly.
And let's be clear on those.
Definitely.
Are there many times where you kind of have those people that feel that they've just accepted that they're going to be injured or in pain for a long period of time, roughly speaking? Are there many times where you just see that person and they're like, oh, no, you're done in, mate. I'm sorry. There's not much I can do for you.
There are some people who don't get better. And what I see a lot of times is it's trust. And this is one thing that I can beat myself up about, because I messaged Uwe a while ago about it, saying I get sometimes a bit frustrated when some people don't get better. And one thing he said to me is about, well, it's, people don't necessarily always understand that therapeutic partnership and their involvement in that as well. Because a lot of times when you imagine you've been to hospital appointments your whole life, you're going there and you get expecting answers, and you expect those people can only give you answers, and you kind of outsource your thinking to those professionals, when in reality, it's you go into that professional, you trust what they say, and then you need to commit to what they do, and you're looking for those changes. Some people really struggle with that, and this isn't hitting people with the judgment stick, but when you've been integrated in a process for 20, 30 years of being told, you know, chronic changes and all this business, it's hard to get around that. So what I see a few times, I'll have people come in and bring their MRI results in. Almost like I had one person almost just throw them on the table at me. He's like, I'm broken, that's it. And I read through the MRI results. I'm like, actually, this isn't that bad. And if you look at a typical sort of 50-year-old, you'll probably see these changes. And they might be actually incidental to your pain. They might not be causing your pain. Because an MRI is an objective picture, but the interpretation is always subjective. And so one quick thing they did a few years ago, they got a lady in the States to go around different doctors and get MRI scans for her back pain. She had 30 different MRI scans, saw 30 different doctors, and across those 30 diagnoses, not a single diagnosis was consistent.
Wow.
So it's about using those things that can direct your assessment, but an MRI scan isn't a complete assessment.
So I'd like to move on to some question stuff.
Yep.
But first, I've actually got a personal question. So I'm quite a big fan of Kelly Sturrett, if you've heard of him. And he had a guy on talking to him called Gary Rinnell, who was the guy who coined the term RICE, like rest, ice, compression, elevation training. Mm-hmm. And he wrote a book called Iced, mm-hmm. Saying that he's kind of changed his opinion on ice and injuries.
Yeah.
And it's something kind of, I personally read the book and I thought that kind of makes sense to in my head what he's explained there. Mm-hmm. And then since doing that, I don't ice injuries when I'll give people that advice if they ask me.
Mm.
But I just wanted to know your thoughts on ice and injuries.
So I'll flip the question back to you. Now, why would you recommend not to use ice?
So from what I understood, ice is... So when you get a swelling on an injury, it's kind of the... Again, this is going to be very wrong, I'm sure. Mm. It's like deoxygenated blood and that kind of thing. We want to kind of increase circulation to that area because that's where all the nutrients or whatever is going into that area. So ice is going to kind of restrict your restrict blood flow to the area. Mm. It's good for if you want to numb pain, but then your lymphatic system, where all that stuff is getting drained away, that only works if it works on like a cylindrical kind of compression system.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want stuff to drain away, you need to either have it compressed or movement.
Yeah.
And icing doesn't fit into that model, basically, is what my very rough understanding reading this book about.
It was
about
a pretty good explanation.
It was very complex.
I know, I was going to say.
It was good, though.
And yeah, so I'd probably... It's context for everything, right? And so historically, we always talk like rice, ice, compression, rest, ice, compression, elevation. But yeah, I would agree with you. So inflammation is a natural process. And so if you think of a typical injury, you've got three phases. You've got an inflammatory phase, which is where you're in pain, it's hot, swollen, and that typically can last anywhere between 3 to 5 days. Then you've got something called a proliferation phase. And so these phases all kind of cross over each other, but your proliferation phase is where you start to lay down sort of granulation tissue, where collagen, which kind of gives strength to certain joints, starts to lay down. And then the final phase is the remodeling phase, where most of your loading and your strength work starts to get tissues the way you want them to be. And so the thought behind icing is you disrupt that inflammatory phase to a degree. And so the context, what I would say is I don't ice injuries. If I have a bit of a problem, I'll just kind of go with it. However, in a professional sports environment, some of the research would suggest that by icing in a performance environment, so when I used to do skeleton, if I was racing the next day and I trained, would ice to try and reduce that amount of inflammation to maintain performance.
Just like an ice bath would.
Yeah, and that's what we'd do. And fun times, taking me back
wheelie bin.
Yeah.
Bag of ice.
Or we used to punch a hole in the lake and go for a swim. But so it's not very strong either way, the evidence for icing, because you could argue, and some of the research has shown us that it doesn't go deep enough into the tissues. But in terms of pain management strategies, I would use it for some people when it's become a little bit more chronic, just to kind of desensitize those tissues a bit. Because at the same time, you don't want to disrupt the inflammatory process, but you also want people to move. And if they're not going to move without icing, I would rather them ice and move than not ice.
Someone, let's say in a jiu-jitsu context, then someone, I don't know, sprain their ankle on the mat or, you know, their elbow hurt a little bit, would you put a cold compress on just to get home or not?
I wouldn't really. I mean, everyone's probably got their own thoughts on it. But I think that inflammatory phase is an important one, particularly if we're recreational athletes and we're not kind of pushing for the next Olympic Games, not all of us anyway. And so I would probably just crack on. One, everyone's an expert though. And I remember being at a club where someone had quite a nasty fracture in their ankle. And so someone needs to get x-rayed, like, can't step on it, it's a big problem. And then someone popped in, one of the more experienced grapplers was like, no mate, you just need to get in a nice warm bath and it'll get much better. I'm like, no, get it x-rayed. But yeah, so it's context. But you know, for people with longer term pain, there's certain things I'll ask people to ice for, just to kind of get their pain under control. I'd rather them move more than anything, because lack of movement is a big stopper in rehab.
Sure.
Thanks for your answer for that. Well,
thanks for the question.
Appreciate
the question.
Are we using ice or not? That's what I want to know.
I'm going to continue not using ice unless I'm into
and I'll do what most physios say and just say it depends.
Mike, what's your answer?
Well, I'm still going to use kind of cold water therapy, I think, and hot cold, because I just kind of like the feeling anyway. Yeah. But I think personally, I quite like if I've like bumped my head or something, just a bit of something cold, maybe it just takes the pain away.
Well, or why don't you give it a little kiss better?
Yeah, no, I'm sticking with the ice.
But it's one of those things.
We offer that at the gym. So just if anyone does, and if you want a cold compress, you can have one.
Just speak to Mike about it.
Don't. Depends if you come to Michael.
Yeah. I'll give you a kiss better. Mike, give you a compress.
It's funny. It's a strange
thing. So let's move on to some of the questions we've got asked on the Instagrams. And feel free to blitz through this as quick or as slow as you see. I've given you a quick look at the questions, so you'll know which ones you want to spend more time on and which ones we can move on quickly. So first one from Gracie Barra Harrogate about fixing shoulder mobility. More of a statement than a question there.
Yep.
But any thoughts around shoulder mobility? Is it something that you see a lot of people suffer from?
Yeah, you see it a lot in judo. Obviously, because judo is like super top heavy, yanking and pulling people around by the gi. But you obviously see it in jiu-jitsu. Shoulder mobility, there's a few things, and I'm probably going to cop out on most of these questions and saying an important part of it is an assessment. So it's what's driving that lack of range of movement. And so mobility is your ability to kind of access full joint range actively. And so there are a lot of people who go and just passively stretch things, but is a stretch, can you achieve that range actively without having to stretch to get into it? And a big thing when you look at things like hypermobility is people have more passive range than they have active range. And so when there's a gap in that, they're at more risk of injury because there's certain aspects of the joint they can go through without having a muscular strength through there. And so fixing shoulder mobility is a case of finding out what's driving the range of movement, what's the desired range of movement. And then what we do a little bit in the clinic is some of this thing called functional range assessment. It's formed by a black belt called Andreas Spina over in the States. And it's about looking at what the joint capacity is and then helping people generate the strength to transmit forces through those ranges and get strength through those ranges. So a big part of it, I'll use an example, someone coming to clinic, a bit of a bodybuilder, powerlifting type, terrible shoulder range. It's like my traps hurt, my neck hurts, and he probably couldn't get his arms up to his ears. They were super stiff. And so what we worked on with him was giving him strength through that shoulder range. There wasn't a lot of stretching, but there was a lot of active strength work into end ranges. And I think there's very much an old school mentality as we develop flexibility by stretching more. But in reality, if you can't access those range with active strength, you're not going to be using it effectively. So in short, to address shoulder mobility, I would challenge joint ranges with hard sort of muscle contractions at end ranges.
Excellent. So the next one is from Bob Hardin, stuck his name on the end, so I'm sure he's okay with
having
it.
Thanks, Bob.
Any advice for the older student? And of course, we've mentioned Tom already changed jiu-jitsu, and so as the context,
I guess this is kind of staying healthy and staying in the game for as long as possible, right?
Yeah, and I think that's kind of what most of us want when we're training, really, isn't it? It's being robust, and so not just always playing to your strengths and developing a bit more of a wider game in terms of your movement patterning. So as we get a little bit older, we reinforce habits, the way we walk, the way we move, the way we hold ourselves. And so it's about developing strength and capacity. So a lot of people see strength training as going to the gym, just getting strong. What do you squat? What do you bench? What do you deadlift? And in reality, it's about, are you preparing those muscles and those joints to deal with the demands that are placed upon them? And so injury always occurs when the force that goes through the joint isn't matched by the capacity at the joint. So we'll do some of this stuff. Obviously, we start producing video content, but it's about developing strength, developing about range of movement, and developing muscle capacity and strength in certain ranges to increase your longevity, really.
Excellent.
I think another thing on that, from a jiu-jitsu school owner's perspective, is making smart choices when you train.
Yeah.
So it's like, and this goes for any age group, right? It's about rolling in the right way.
Mm.
It's about expressing yourself in jiu-jitsu in the right way. And you could go to a gym which is very competitive and high energy. If you want to have longevity in your jiu-jitsu journey, it's probably not the place to go. I would seek out a gym which is a bit more holistic and focus on health like ours, right?
Yeah, I remember listening to Faraz Abi speak one time about that, about he much prefers a student to be rolling and training with the intent of staying injury-free and train consistently for a longer period of time than training 7 days a week, 6 days a week, hard for 2 months, gets injuries, out for another month, and then he's on and off.
And he speaks with a certain amount of experience and knowledge. So for people who don't know who he is, who is he, T?
He's the head coach at TriStar Jiu-Jitsu and the head coach for George St. Pierre, the UFC fighter.
So he knows what he's talking about.
Yeah.
And I just think to add on that, we were talking about this earlier, Mike, it is about the culture of the gym and also mindset and ego. Probably last year, not the year before, because last year was a bit of a write-off, I kept breaking my toe.
Kicking walls, Tom.
Yeah, that's it. Well, actually, I did that in a roll. I used to train in a bit of an old mill, and so I kicked the wall when I tried to hit bridge. And what I decided to do from that point was, like, I'm training too hard, and if I keep training like this, I'm just going to keep getting this toe injured. So every session I said, you know what, if someone absolutely destroys me, that's fine. I'm going to go at 40-50%. These are my focus points. And so if someone taps me, like, I had people who've never tapped me before tap me, throw the ego in the bin a little bit and just focus on your processes.
That's awesome advice, man. And also, you know, that allows you then to train, like you say, with injury, because there's always something you can develop. Mm. I mean, it goes back to your point about always kind of going to your strengths as well. I'm going to be encouraging all our students to play to their weaknesses. Mm. And if you're a great top game player, we should be playing guard more often like I do. And understanding then that you want to become the complete jiu-jitsu fighter, right?
So the next question is, I'm sure again, we can cover it quickly because I'm sure it'll be similar to maybe the shoulder kind of mobility thing. But hip mobility is a big one for me. Be good to get some tips just around hip mobility.
Yeah, so not a lot of jiu-jitsu players actually have that good hip mobility unless you're training at 10th Planet. So for those who don't know, 10th Planet's a gym run by a guy called Eddie Bravo, who's got quite an unorthodox approach to jiu-jitsu. And he trains all of their athletes to be super flexible. A lot of the techniques they use require a lot of hip mobility and space. But typically, what you'll find when people first start training jiu-jitsu is they'll use a lot of strength. They'll be hanging on, they'll be in closed guard, they'll be squeezing their legs together, and they develop a lot of tightness in those adductor muscles on the inside of the legs. And so, like we talked about, it's developing a wider and more diverse game. And also do some specific joint work, looking at getting some strength into your hips in different ranges. And that's, once again, feels like a bit of a pitch here, but it's going to see the right person with the knowledge who can say, I understand the demands of what jiu-jitsu are, and then this is how we're going to help you meet those demands.
And I'm actually doing some stuff now, which you've prescribed for me, right, working on that hip range, the 90-90 transitions and stuff.
Yeah.
And like already, and this, I'm not saying it because you're here, already I know that I feel different in my hips.
Yeah.
And already I've got an improvement in my range of motion.
Yeah.
And the comfortable feeling of sat upright in that 90-90, which I didn't have.
Yeah.
I now feel like I've got better posture. So it can happen real quick too, right? As soon as you start to implement some of these changes, some of these practices, but real quick, it goes back to what you're saying. You've got to commit to it.
Yeah.
You've got to be doing it every single morning, getting it done. And
yep,
your tea.
Yep. I need to start, of course. Bit in-depth kind of one. I'm going to mess up some pronunciations
here. Go for it.
Bancart, labral tear, and shallow hill sacs lesion on shoulder. What post-surgery rehab?
So that's one that comes down to an assessment. So that's quite a complex fracture that you'll get in the shoulder. It usually comes with an anterior dislocation. Don't want to cop out here, but what you'll find is, I've got a little bit of an Instagram account going. It's not the most popular in the world, but I get quite a lot of engagement on it. And I'll get questions saying, I've got back pain. What's the best exercise for back pain? Or the best exercise for knee pain? And it's a case of understanding you, your history, what's going on, and prescribing the right thing. And so it'd be a case of finding out what the surgery was, how they managed it, how many weeks ahead are you, what are your demands, what do you want to get back to. So in that case, to do credit to the physio, because if I sent you some exercises, you'd be like, it's probably a really bad physio. It's a case of just looking at how you're presenting and then how we can treat it based on your expectations.
For sure. And Tom's Instagram will be linked in the description along with Indergaard's, if anyone wants to link up with Tom. Next question. How will training affect patellofemoral pain syndrome? Is that right?
Yeah. Depends. You'll have to find when you train.
Yeah.
But it's another one of these things where PFJ pain, in short, is just knee pain in essence. So it's where your patella meets your femur. And some people can get them for different reasons. You see it in a lot of guys who squat quite a lot. And you might see a bit of pain. Sometimes in kneeling, it depends on kind of the nature and strength in the joint. And so it's one of the advantages we're going to have with this partnership is we get to touch base on these things. So, you know, I can say, if you come see me and if you're happy with me sharing some of this information with Mike, we can say, right, when you train, we want you to work in this position. We want to develop strength in this position while we rehab it appropriately.
Excellent. I think that probably already covers the last question of how to prevent a sore knee. Maybe we can go on a bit more on prevention kind of things.
Yeah, and it'll come back to some of the videos we do. It's the right technique. It's the capacity you've got for load, and are you accessing those joint ranges appropriately? And where are you compensating, and how do we address those compensations?
Excellent. Tom, do you want to just to finish this up, maybe just to talk a little bit about Indergaard, and maybe just any of the kind of things you wanted to address to give people a bit more information about who you guys are and that kind of thing?
Yeah, so Indergaard Physio, we're based in Garforth. We're at Monday to Saturday. And I think having spoken to quite a lot of clinics, a big part of my professional development and wanting to be better was finding the right place to be. And we mentioned this before, but what I've seen in the development of COVID is an increased amount of video consultations. And I had a bit of a discussion with a physio who I trained with, and he said to me, well, it's great. They really badly fractured their ankle. I said, oh, it's great. I get to do loads more video consultations and build like patient independence. I was like, well, what's your measure? Like, how do you know they're getting better? He's like, oh, discharge. And I'm like, well, how do you quantify a successful discharge? So, well, you know, they're not in the service anymore, but it's not any input from the patient. It's not what they want to do. It's the physio's prescribed a baseline. And if they hit that baseline, that's good enough to discharge them. Whereas at Indergaard, it's a case of we get to see someone face to face. We get to assess them. They walk out going, I've got this problem. And in this time frame, I can get better. And also, we've got some really cool tools. So we deal with a lot of kind of shoulder problems. And if you've ever heard, have you ever heard of something called a bursitis?
Yeah, I had bursitis in both my knees.
Yeah, typical jiu-jitsu.
You're number one customer.
And so a bursitis is you, between your shoulder joint, you've got a lot of space where some of the muscles and tendons run. And the bursa is like a thick bag of fluid, and that helps lubricate the joint. And if you fall on your hand, or sometimes it can develop through poor loading, that bursa becomes like thick and quite hot, quite grumpy, and it limits your range of movement. So typically, the pathway would be someone has a bursitis, we rest it, and we start to gradually introduce strength. But what we know is we use things like shockwave, or we've got another machine called electromagnetic transduction therapy, which goes right into the joint and massively improves the speed of the recovery. So I have one client at the moment who fell on his arm, had a really nasty bursitis, really swollen, really hot. You could even feel it through his shoulder, the temperature. And he kept coming back to see me. He's like, it's not quite there. So he then decided, and we talked about shockwave before, to use shockwave therapy, and came back to see me today, actually. And after 1 week, he's like, my shoulder pain's gone. Wow. And so then that gives us a window to say, now we can strengthen you, whereas the pain was inhibiting that before. So that's, you know, 4 or 5 weeks off his rehab because we've got the right equipment to do that.
Excellent. Mike, was it before we kind of start signing this off, is there any questions you had for Tom?
I've got lots about my own mobility, but we'll get to that. No, not so much questions now. I think what I want people to feel, the people who are listening to this, if they're members of ours, is that they should have confidence that if you come and train with us, two things. One, you're going to be protected by us as instructors, and this is a safe place to train with a great culture of supportive community and people are safe to come and express themselves in jiu-jitsu. And two, should the worst happen, or maybe you have an injury and you're sat there thinking, I'd love to start jiu-jitsu, but I don't know where to start because of my knee, my elbow. We've got the best people in the business right by our side, and you can access them, and it's a two-way conversation, right? Yeah. So it should give people confidence that we are 100% invested in their health holistically. And I'm just excited to have Tom and me on board.
I think to second that as well, having trained at quite a lot of jiu-jitsu gyms, I think you've kind of trying to develop this culture, aren't you, of rolling safely, developing your jiu-jitsu, and for that path to be more of a linear path than being stopped by all of these injuries that occur. You know, there's plenty of times I've trained and I've gone into gyms and I've woken up the next day and I've just gone to war for an hour where I just feel broken, and I'm like, it doesn't feel sustainable. It just feels like you're in a bit of a fight. And I think, you know, you mentioned it, you'd had conversations with people who you thought maybe don't quite fit the culture. Yep. And you know, you can have that with them. And I think it's for people to feel safe coming through the doors, because it's a sport that requires us to fight each other and to challenge joint ranges. But at the same time, it doesn't mean it can't be done safely, given the right instruction.
Excellent. Well, Tom, we didn't actually get much of a chance to talk about your own kind of jiu-jitsu and style and philosophy around and that kind of thing. So we'll definitely have you back on if you have some time. We'll just talk all about jits and
that
kind of thing. But thank you very much for coming on today. Members, definitely reach out to Tom and Indergaard and get all your injuries and become more prepared for the trials of jiu-jitsu ahead. And until next time, guys, thank you very much. Tom, thank you, Mike.
Cheers, thank you.
See you next time.
Cheers, guys.
Bye.